Okay, let's look now at the option of doing an offset, an offset in time for a single value. In other words, we want to retrieve just a single value, but that's going to be offset by some period of time. So to set this up, the first thing we'll do is we'll go ahead and set this back to what it was by default, which is automatic. And then we could specify this to be some offset in time. I'll go back -3 hours, and we'll set this to not supported. That just means it's not going to do any calculations. And what we get when we finish that is it's going backwards by 3 hours and showing me the value as of 3 hours. And it's doing that using an automatic calculation. That's what this auto stands for. And what automatic means is that if this is a type of tag, that a real-time tag, we would interpolate the value. So we'll look in the archive, we'll figure out what's before and after it, and interpolate a value exactly at that time. Now, if it's a tag that's more like a manual input or quality tag, something we would call a tag with the step attribute set equal to on, then we would do a before. And what that means is we would get the last value before the time provided. So if we were to, it basically automatic either gives you interpolated or before, on or before. Here, this one right here, at or before. So it'll either give you the value exactly at that timestamp or the one before. And these other options here are all in service of that kind of an option or that kind of a behavior. See, if I were to say explicitly, I would like to see the value at or before -3 hours, watch what happens to my value over here. It's going to retrieve not an interpolated value, but it's going to look into our archive and retrieve the last value before that time, or if there is a value exactly at that timestamp, it'll give you that exact value. Now, when I check this in, that's what we're going to end up seeing in Process Book. So let me go ahead and reset this. As you can see, this is that last value before, the last value before the end time. Now, the interesting thing about this calculation is as I scroll backward, notice now, this now becomes the end time in the context of that retrieval. So this is now looking 3 hours before that end time and giving me the last value before that. So I go back again. Let's see, this is now, imagine 3 hours before this 120, and it's giving me the value before that. Looks like it's the value right about there. Let's see if I can hover at that and see that. Yeah, that's at 944. Let me go back again. So we're going to go 3 hours before this, which is about right here, and then the value before that, which is this one here. Let's see, is that our value? 86.4, yeah, there we go, at 133. So you see, that's the behavior if you have, if you're using this type of an offset. The offset is going to, within Process Book, it's going to be treating the end time of your trend as that current time. So when we specify -3 hours, that has one meaning when you're just looking at it here. But as I said, we pick up context. So depending on what your context is, that's what we're going to show. In this case, it's 3 hours before. Let's go with another one. Yeah, here's 220, or at 520. So we're going to go to 220 and find the value before that. And the value before that, I think it was this value right here. Yeah, there we go, right about 94.1. The other options that you have here, we saw the at or before. There's also an option called exact time. And by exact time, what we mean is we will attempt to get a value at exactly that time if there is a value. But if there is no value, we simply say there is no value there. And you'll see this show up in the Process Book display. Now see, it says no events found. Now, if I were to keep scrolling back, keep doing this for a while, odds are I might find an exact timestamp where we had a value, and in that case we would show it. Now, what would you possibly use that for? Well, we actually have customers that would like to verify that things like lab inputs have been entered at precise times, and or any are any of the lab values missing. So that's why we support this exact time. Now, of course, if you were to change this, then that would change what timestamp we're looking for. After is exactly the opposite of what we were looking at for the before. So those are our different options for looking at these values in different ways. Now, do you remember in an earlier video, we took a look at how you could use this substitution syntax with the data reference here to this lab tag. We used the substitution syntax to give a name to the tags that are going to be created automatically when tag creation is turned on. So we used the substitution syntax to go ahead and substitute the name of the element and the name of the attribute. And we could actually even go further. And I think we demonstrated this with the extended descriptor. We showed how we could actually define that the tag that you're going to create is actually going to go out and get these substituted values, or go grab actual values from the elements and use those in the tag creation. We can use a variation of that within this these value calculations that we're doing right now. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Using a combination of a substitution and an enumeration set, I can specify that the average, min, and max that I'm doing here are actually going to be keyed off of whatever the user selects here for a time offset. And the time offset is just an element that's defined to have a value type of an enumeration set that you can create on your own. So if I switch this to 4 days, for example, and then I go ahead and refresh, you can also press F5 to do that. Notice what happens. We're going to go back and get new values. Now our max, min, and average change because now we're looking at a time offset of 4 days as opposed to, say, 2 hours. We do that and then refresh the screen. And now we're getting different results. So the idea here is that using this substitution, we can actually go out and make reference or make retrievals for the average, min, and max that are conditional based on what's selected by the user. It's not easy, that's for sure, and it does require that you get familiar with this substitution syntax. But let me show you how we would do something like this. The first thing we would do is we would create an enumeration set that has those timestamps that we want. So I just created an enumeration set called enum1, and I created these values here. Now, just a point, make a quick point here. You can't use the asterisk when you're creating these enumeration sets. So if you decide you do want to do this, instead of using asterisk minus 1h, that would be considered an illegal character in the enumeration set because the asterisk is actually used as a wildcard character. Instead, just use the relative references here, minus 4 hours, minus 12 hours, etc. So we set up an enumeration set called enum1. Now the next thing we do is we go into this generic tank template. This is where we're specifying these averages, min and max, and we add a brand new attribute that we're just calling time offset. The time offset has been defined to have a value type that matches that enumeration set. If you remember, we could go ahead and choose that as a value type, and the beauty of that is now, you know, I can specify what the default interval of time is, and then the user at runtime can make use of this dropdown as well. So this is in the configuration. This is in the template configuration. I'll go ahead and check all that in. And then the big finish to this is when you make reference to this average and you're determining what interval of time you would like to use in this time range calculation, then you make a reference using that substitution syntax to the time offset attribute. It actually will go using this, the percent sign, and the at symbol. It's a flag that indicates that what we're doing here is we're making reference to the value of this attribute. That's the attribute that's at the current level. And you can actually go up one level. If you recall, there was syntax where I believe it was something like this. You could go up one level if the attribute existed at a higher level. You can find all that in your AF user guide if you want to know more about this substitution syntax. But by doing it like that, once I go out and I actually look at the elements, and I did that, by the way, for the maximum and the minimum as well, now that's what ties the average, etc., to whatever the user selects here. So if I go to 7 days and then refresh my screen, we're going to get a different set of results here. You can see the average, the min, and the max are going to change. And they're changing because, as you can see, if we look at the settings, we're making reference to that time as a time offset.